Now, does anybody know what time it is? Kids. Hey, there's some enthusiasm. All right. Good morning, good morning. Come closer. Come closer. You're allowed to sit on the floor. Come on. All right. Well, suppose you were at your friend's house. Do you have friends? You have friends? You ever go to their house?
Two.
You have two friends? You ever go to their house? Yeah? Well, suppose you were at your friend's house and you're visiting and you saw laying in their living room. Have you ever seen this movie?
Yes.
Princess Bride?
It's a good movie.
You like that movie, huh? And you saw this laying there and nobody was around. They were all in other rooms. And you thought to yourself, I really like that movie. But you know there's not time to watch it there, so you think, I would really like to watch that movie at home. So you just picked it up and stuffed it in your shirt and took it home. Would you do that?
No.
Why not?
Because.
What's that?
Stealing.
It's called, but even, but if you really, really wanted it?
I would still not steal it.
You wouldn't steal it? You wouldn't take it? Would you take it? No? Well, that's good. Well, how about...
My friend for when I was four.
You what?
I have known my friend since I was four.
Oh, you've known for a long time, so you wouldn't want to take... How about if you were...
Definitely no.
You were in their bedroom...
Definitely no.
And you saw that they had this Bible, and you saw that they have several other Bibles in their house... And you thought, I don't have a Bible like this. This is, oh, you looked at it and thought, oh, man, this is like an antique. And I would really like it. You wouldn't take it? But it's the Bible. God wants you to read the Bible.
We can read it there.
You can read it there? But what you want to read it at home? What if you want to read it every day?
I'll just go down to their house.
Just go to their house every day.
Or I can ask them if they can borrow it.
Or ask them if you could borrow it? Really? But what if you just really wanted it yourself?
I'll go buy a new one.
You'd go buy a different one. So you wouldn't take it?
No. I would ask.
Oh, okay. Well, how about if it was a banana in their room?
Uh-huh.
Yeah? You like bananas?
I wouldn't take it.
And you go, well, they probably already had bananas. This is probably an extra. Would you grab it off their dresser and eat it?
No.
No,
I would ask them first.
But what if you're afraid they'll say no?
I would just go home.
You'd just go home and get something to eat. But you really wanted a banana and you're really hungry.
What if that's their parents?
You'd have to ask them? So you wouldn't just take it?
Nope.
But it's good for you.
It's called stealing.
It's still called stealing, huh? Okay. How about a pack of gum?
No.
You saw that in their room. You like gum? Yeah? And you'd say, well, you know, they probably have lots of other packs of gum, and it's just gum. I mean, really. Would you stick it in your pocket and take it home?
No. I would ask.
But it's just gum.
I would ask.
You would ask? Okay. What about a cough drop? You wouldn't take a cough drop? But what if you were sick and you were coughing and they weren't around and it's sitting there? Would you take it?
No.
Would you take it?
Only if it's, yeah, coughing.
You would take it?
If you're coughing,
but it doesn't belong to you.
I would still ask.
You would ask, but you would take it. What if they said no? Would you take it?
No.
But it's just a cough drop.
No means no.
It's not that big a deal.
No means no. It's messy.
So you wouldn't even steal a cough drop?
No.
Why not? Because it's wrong, right? Because we're supposed to do the right things. Even with the little things. So this would be a big deal. This would still be a big deal. Because we have to do the right things, even if it's the little things. And that's what makes us super sheep, when we obey even in the little, little things. Right? Right. All right. So, no stealing my stuff. Right? Stand up. Well, a couple of items of note before we get into the message. First one is, another reminder of the 5 to 10 list, bookmark list. As we've talked about before, the most important thing is for us to let people see Christ. And so this is just a tool. It's the most important bookmark that you have. And if somebody said, well, I only read books on my Kindle. Well, tape it to the inside of your Kindle or put it on your dashboard or your refrigerator to remind you to pray for and to reach out. Because the more you pray for these, the folks that are there, and what I want you to do is to identify the people that you believe God wants you to reach out and pray for. Not, you know, it's fine to pray for a relative that lives 1,000 miles away and you want to pray for them. But here what we're talking about is people that you can actually interact with. So be sure and use that. Secondly, after the week of prayer and fasting, about a week later, I felt very strongly that God wants me to put together a bunch of the From Where God Sits articles that I've been writing since the mid-90s. And I've, you know, people have told me I should do this. I've thought about doing this, but after the week of prayer and fasting, about a week after, I felt like God said, it's time. You need to do it now. Have you ever tried to write a book? Have you? Even though they're all written, I've spent hours of editing and tweaking and trying to figure out which ones to put in the book. And since God has said that, I feel like he's going to use it as a tool to reach people's lives for us as a congregation. And so what I would ask you to do, especially in the next, because I felt like he wanted me to get it done by August 1st. So I need your prayers for strength and clarity and focus. I ask Amber, my daughter who graduated with an art degree, I finally found a way for her to use it. And she went out that day. She lives in Seattle. She went out that day to a park close to where she lives. She took this photograph, and then she's putting the cover together. So that's what it's going to look like. And I saw that, and I thought, that's perfect. Out in God's creation, from where God sits, and it just resonated. But I need your prayers to finish the editing. I have to get it to the printer Thursday. So please, if you could pray, I would appreciate that. And pray that God will use it to reach out into our community. Because as I thought about it, there's something that, you know, if I hand a book to somebody that I'm trying to reach out to, it just raises the legitimacy and you know, people looking at it instead of just handing them a card. So I think that's a big part of what God's going to do. And then finally, please continue to pray for the three items that we have identified over the last several months. Praying for spiritual awakening, revival, that we would reach the lost and the lonely and provide financial and people resources. Ordinary, extraordinary super sheep. That's what we started last week. We started with three people, and we have each week we have the sheep represented up here. So I don't know if you can read these or not. But last week we looked at Lydia, Epaphroditus, and notice Epaph is his online name, I guess. I don't know. Dorcas, and then today we're going to talk about Mordecai. Characteristics of the ordinary, extraordinary super sheep that we identified last week was they thought they were just ordinary, and they were. They risked to follow God. That's the follow part, and this staff represents the follow part, following Jesus. They served others at cost to themselves. That's the flocking part of our theme for the year. and the fence represents the flocking, being together. And then they live for God and the kingdom. That's the cape, super sheep. And then they also found great joy, freedom, and satisfaction in doing it. It wasn't a grind. It was hard at times, but it was full of joy and freedom and satisfaction. Today we want to talk about another super sheep who risked to do the right things. His name is Mordecai. And many of you are probably familiar with the book of Esther. And you might even recognize the name of Mordecai. But this sermon is not about Esther. There's old movies and all kinds of things about Esther. But Mordecai is not recognized for being the super sheep that he was. We would not have the story of Esther if it wasn't for Mordecai. We would not have Jewish holiday of Purim, I think that's how you pronounce it, Purim, without Mordecai helping to save millions of Jews in a kingdom that extended from India all the way to Ethiopia. Millions of Jews were saved through Esther, but because of Mordecai. It would never have happened if he wasn't providing the wisdom, the encouragement, the direction, the prayer, the fasting, and the support that she desperately needed during that time. He was a super sheep. So let's talk about his story. And as we do that, I want you to note how ordinary and how inconvenient his actions were. Because that's really what it means to be a super sheep. It doesn't mean that we're the stars, but it does mean we do the ordinary things and we do the right things, even when we have to risk danger to do it. So let's talk about six risks that Mordecai took. Number one, he adopted his cousin at cost to himself. He seems to have been older than Esther, and he became her father. He adopted her when her parents passed away. Now, some of the scriptures that I'm going to read are going to be on the screen, but they won't be in your outline. The reference is there because there just wasn't room to put them on. Esther chapter 2, beginning with verse 5, says, "Now there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin named Mordecai, son of Jair, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish, who had been carried into exile from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, among those taken captive with Jehoiakim, king of Judah." So what we find is Mordecai's great-grandfather was one of the Jews who had been taken from Israel and into Babylon, probably about the same time as Daniel and the three Hebrews men. And so they were taken from their homeland to Babylon. Verse 7, Mordecai had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he had brought up because she had neither father nor mother. This girl was who was also known as Esther, aren't you glad they chose that one? Was lovely in form and features, so she was beautiful physically. And Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her father and mother had died. So here's Mordecai. He finds out somehow her parents pass away, and he adopts her and takes her as his own. Think about how he had to rearrange his life. We hear about adoption, and you could talk. I was talking to Alicia yesterday. You know what changes since her eyes just got big. Lots of changes with the baby coming in. And so we think about, okay, yeah, he adopted her because she had no parents, but he had to rearrange his schedule, rearrange his finances, rearrange his life, rearrange his heart. He had to change everything. And there was no guarantee that he would have all he needed. He's taking on this responsibility. And so he risked his own well-being in order to take his cousin in. I notice an attitude in some places in our culture where the idea of doing good should not cost us very much. Yes, I should do good. And I see it in some of the secular organizations that I'm a part of. Yeah, I'll help out with the extra that I have. I'll, if somebody's in need, yeah, I've got an extra $20, I'll do that. okay, I've got this evening free. I'll help in this. And what we don't, and that can permeate into us in, when in reality, if we're to really serve as God wants us to serve, it's going to cost us. It means rearranging our schedule. It means maybe canceling some plans that I wanted to have, the things that I wanted to do what God wants me to do, to rearrange my finances. Sometimes it's the idea of, well, maybe I should be reimbursed. If I'm going to help, maybe I should be reimbursed for it somehow. No, if we're going to be super sheep, if we're going to serve and do the right things, we have to, it's going to cost us. And so that was Mordecai. He adopted his cousin at cost to himself. Number two, the second risk is that he raised Esther to serve God in a pagan land. He raised Esther to serve God in a pagan land. He raised her so that what we find later in the story is not, she had physical beauty, she had outward beauty, but he raised her in such a way that her inner beauty shone through to every person that she met. In the Medo-Persian Empire, there was sin and intrigue everywhere. It was not easy being a Jew, and it was certainly not easy being devout to God. But Mordecai was so, and he taught this young lady. We don't know how old she was when he adopted her, but he taught her to serve God, to live for God in the midst of a pagan culture, much worse than ours. And so in this story, what we find is that the king needed a new queen. The last queen had been fired, and now the new queen, they need a new queen. And so his advisor, the king's advisor, said, well, you know, go throughout the land and find the most beautiful unmarried women in the land, and then bring them in here, and then you can choose the one that you want to be your queen. Mordecai had prepared her to serve God, without knowing that this was going to occur and that she would be one of those beautiful young ladies who would be brought to the king. It was dangerous to be Jewish because of the opposition of some high-ranking people in her day. And so we find in Esther chapter 2, verse 10, that Esther had not revealed her nationality and family background because Mordecai had forbidden her to do so. It doesn't mean she wasn't serving God. It was just that she wasn't revealing that she was Jewish. And every day he walked, so she's been taken into the palace, and they're preparing her to meet the king. And every day he walked back and forth near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. He had adopted her. He had become her dad. And I can identify with this because I remember, you know, you send your boys off and you go, okay, they can fend for themselves. But you send your daughters off and you're wondering, are they going to be okay? Amber's first semester in college, she signed up for an Irish studies program. So not only was she leaving our home to go to a college in Indiana, she's going a quarter of the way around the world, across an ocean, to live with in this little group of people from Taylor University that we don't know, and we don't know what they're going to do. And I can identify with Mordecai wondering, is she okay? You know, I had the confidence that Amber was with Christian people, with Christian professors. Here, Esther is in the middle of the pagan Medo-Persian kingdom at the highest levels where power corrupts and kills. And so there he is. Every day he's walking back and forth trying to find out, is she okay? Is she okay? Esther won the favor of every person that she met. As she went into the palace, the attendants we find in the book of Esther, she gained favor with them. And it wasn't because her beauty. All of them were beautiful, but there was something about Esther. In verse 17, we see that now the king was attracted to Esther more than any of the other women, and she won his favor and approval more than any of the other virgins. So he set a royal crown on her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. And the king gave a great banquet, Esther's banquet, for all his nobles and officials. He proclaimed a holiday throughout the provinces and distributed gifts with royal liberality. She won over the king, even though she served God. She hadn't revealed it, but she served God. But she would not have been that person had Mordecai not been there to raise her. Number three, Mordecai saved the king who oppressed his people, who oppressed Mordecai's people, the Jewish people. He saved the king. Now remember, Mordecai's great-grandfather had been taken from Israel, brought to Babylon. And so the Jewish people had been defeated, dispersed, and oppressed. And I can just imagine Mordecai growing up and hearing the stories. Maybe his great-grandfather was still around, but his grandfather, hearing the stories of the Israel, of their land, of the land of Israel, hearing the stories of their homeland, of God's blessings, of the stories of faith, hearing all of those things and realizing he can't go back there. He is stuck where he is. The natural human tendency would be to hate the king because he is oppressing our people and he is not allowing us to go back home. And I have to serve in this land that I don't want to be. That would be the natural tendency. But that's not what Mordecai did. Esther chapter 2, verse 21 says, during the time Mordecai was sitting at the king's gate, Bigthana and Teresh, I have no idea if that's the right pronunciation or not. I'm glad that's the only time they're mentioned in the story. Two of the king's officers who guarded the doorway became angry and conspired to assassinate King Xerxes. Now, if that our human tendency, you overhear that and you go, good. He's the king who won't let us go home. Maybe the next king would be better. He'll finally get what he deserves. But Mordecai was committed to doing the right thing. Even if it's a cough drop, he's not going to steal it. Mordecai found out about the plot and told Queen Esther, who in turn reported it to the king, giving credit to Mordecai. And when the report was investigated and found to be true, the two officials were hanged on a gallows. All this was recorded in the book of the annals in the presence of the king. So here is Mordecai. He saves the king. He overhears it, sends the message. Now, if he had not said anything, most of us would not have considered him guilty of doing anything wrong. It's simply that he neglected to do the right. I think this is one of the hard parts for us in doing the right thing. Is it's one thing not to steal. It's another thing to make sure the best is being done for somebody that you don't even like. It's another thing to not neglect and then allowing someone to get hurt. You understand what I'm saying? Is we're just as guilty if we neglect to do something that is the right thing than if we did as if we did it ourselves. So we need to challenge ourselves. Are we committed to doing the right thing, even when we could stand by and let it happen and nobody would accuse us of being guilty? Even when it's the boss that no one likes. Even when it's the neighbor that no one cares for. Even if it's the relative that you would just rather not have around. Neglecting to do what's best for them is the same as hurting them. So he saved the king. He did the right thing, even when he didn't have to. Number four, he refused to bow down to man. He refused to bow down. There are bows, and then there are bows. Some are bows of respect, and we find people in the Bible doing that, bowing in respect. But others are bows of reverence. And in the Old Testament, the people of God were instructed, you will not bow down in reverence to anyone or anything. And so it was forbidden. And Mordecai refused to do that. And so he risked to do the right thing, even when a whole lot of other people were telling him he should. Esther chapter 3, verse 1 says, after these events, King Xerxes honored Haman, elevating him and giving him a seat of honor higher than that of all the other nobles. In other words, he promotes him to vice emperor. All the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman, for the king had commanded this concerning him. But Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor. So the king says, bow down to Haman. Mordecai says, I will not do it because I'm committed to doing the right thing. Verse 3, then the royal officials at the king's gate asked Mordecai, why do you disobey the king's command? Day after day they spoke to him, but he refused to comply. In other words, they were telling him, Mordecai, bow. Stop causing trouble. Stop making waves. Bow down. It's not that big a deal. Just bow down. You're going to get yourself in trouble. You're going to get your people in trouble. Bow down and save everybody. Therefore, they told Haman about it to see whether Mordecai's behavior would be tolerated, for he had told them he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor, he was enraged. Yet having learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all of Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. By risking to do the right thing, Mordecai brought the wrath of the vice emperor down on him. Angry, to the point where he said, I don't want to just kill Mordecai. I want to wipe out all the Jewish people. At this point, Mordecai could have caved. Because as these people are saying, look, it's not just about you. It's about all of the Jews. Just bow down. Don't make it a big deal. You'll save your people. And that voice in his head could have caused him to bow down and justify it. Well, if I bow down, I will save the people. But when God has a plan to save his people, we have to follow his plan. And his plan was not for Mordecai to bow down. In fact, if Mordecai had bowed down, we probably would have never heard of Mordecai because he would have been going against God's plan. When it appears not to make sense to do the right thing, do it anyway. We live in a culture that justifies all kinds of action where the end justifies the means. God is as concerned with the means as he is with the end. And we need to do what he wants us to do. Do the right thing and do not compromise, because we will not fulfill God's plan if we compromise. Well, Haman convinces the king that the Jews don't obey God, the laws of the land, which was a lie. He convinced the king that the Jews were bad for the whole kingdom, which was a lie. And he convinced the king that they all should be killed. Now remember, this is a kingdom that extends from India to Ethiopia. So we're talking about not just the Jews in the city. We're talking about Jews in most of the, you know, probably half of the known world. Millions of Jews. And so Haman convinces the king that they should be killed. And he allows Haman to issue a decree that that should happen on a specific day. And that brings us to risk number 5. Mordecai confronted Esther, asking her to risk her life. He confronted Esther. Esther had been queen about 4 or 5 years at this point. And her character shows through again, because she could have gotten all high and mighty. She's the queen of the land. She can do whatever she wants. And she doesn't have to listen to Mordecai anymore. But that wasn't the case. He went and he confronted Esther, even when she balked. Because, and the problem was, nobody was allowed to go into the king's presence unless they were invited, unless they were called upon. And so for Esther to go before the king was to risk her own life. It's easy to pull back from confrontation. It's easy to let things go. And we'll never probably face a situation as urgent as Mordecai. But there are times when we have to confront people that we care about, because they need to act. or they need to stop doing something that they're doing. Super sheep know that there are times when we must address the difficult things with other people, with people that we care about. Don Shula, who was coach of the Miami Dolphins for years, was talking to a reporter about a player's mistake in practice. He said, "We never let an error go unchallenged. Uncorrected errors multiply." Then the reporter said, "Isn't there benefit in overlooking one small flaw?" Shula said, "What is a small flaw? I think about that all day long. What is a small flaw? I see that with my children. I've let a lot of things slide because I was too tired." Parents, amen. Amen. I didn't want another confrontation, but uncorrected errors do multiply. You've got to face them someday. You might as well face them on the spot. If I could do it over again with my children, I'd face the errors on the spot. It's easier on them, and it's easier on you. That works in relationships with anyone. If there's something under the surface, something you sense that you might as well bring it out. Face it right then. Success lies in the details. Every job is a self-portrait of the person who did it. Autograph your work with excellence. It's easy to let things slide. And again, you know, there are some things that don't matter. But in the things that matter, the things that need correction, we need to have the courage to say, to confront. You're going to put our arm around somebody and say, "You're about to walk off a cliff. I don't want you to walk off a cliff." Well, let's pick it up in Esther chapter 3, verse 13. Dispatches were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces with the order to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and little children, on a single day. Chapter 4. When Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly, because he knew what this meant. He meant the killing of millions of people. But he went only as far as the king's gate, because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter it. In every province in which the edict and order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. It was devastating. What it meant was 12 months from now, on a particular day, there was an order that the people in your country were to come and kill you and your children and your grandchildren, everybody you knew if you were a Jew. That's why the wailing. And with the kingdom extending from India to Ethiopia, there was nowhere to hide. There was no country that you could go to escape it. When Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress. Why is he so upset? She sent clothes for him to put on instead of his sackcloth so that he could approach, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hatak, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to attend her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. So Hatak went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. You see, when Haman went to the king, he even offered to give him like $500,000 to help fund this annihilation. He also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for their annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain it to her. And he told him to urge her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. So Mordecai was confronting her, saying, "Go in to see the king and let him know what's going on." To do that was to risk death. To come into the king's presence without being invited, the law was you would be killed unless the king extended his scepter toward you. Hatak went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, "All the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the gold scepter to him and spare his life. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. I haven't seen him for 30 days. He hasn't asked to see me for 30 days. So it's not like they're eating breakfast together every day and she can talk to him. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. Mordecai is saying, God will not allow his people to be destroyed. And if you don't do this thing, if you don't go to the king, don't think that you're going to be spared. But you and your families, your father's family, will perish. And who knows but that you have come to royal position for such a time as this. Esther, why do you think you got to be queen? Do you think it's because you're so beautiful? Do you think it's because of your character? Those things played a factor, but God has placed you here for this position. Now, the indication seems to be she wasn't thinking that way. And she needed Mordecai to confront her to help her see it. There are times in our lives when we need other people to confront us, to help us to see things, because we can get so blind. Have you ever had someone come to you and talk to you about something and you go, I never saw that? If we see that in another person's life and we fail to do it because we're afraid of confrontation, we're afraid of them not liking us or walking out of our lives, if we're afraid to do that, we will harm them. It's better to chance losing a friend than to watch a friend crash and burn. Verse 15, how did she respond? And Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days. Think about that. We do juice fasts and different things. Don't eat, don't drink, nothing for 3 days. Night or day, I and my maids will fast as you do. And so they went to God because Esther's genuinely afraid. You know, she probably had heard the stories about the previous queen who got kicked out of the queendom because she displeased the king. And so she's genuinely afraid. So what do? They go to God first. Say, fast, pray, seek God. And then, when this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. I love that scripture. Because it's surrender. It's abandonment. It's saying, God, I'm going to do the right thing. And so if I die, I die. So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. Esther goes before the king, and he's pleased to see her. And he extends the scepter. And he asked what she wants. She said, come to a banquet with me and bring Haman with you. They have this banquet. And after they've eaten and drinking, and the king says, well, Esther, what is it that you want? She says, well, if it pleases the king, would you come to dinner again tomorrow with Haman? And there's more to the story. You can read it later. But finally, at that second banquet with just the three of them, the king says, what is it that you want? Esther chapter 7, verse 3 says, then Queen Esther answered, if I have found favor with you, O king, and if it pleases your majesty, grant me my life. This is my petition, and spare my people. This is my request. For I and my people have been sold for destruction and slaughter and annihilation. And the king goes, what are you talking about? He didn't know that she was Jewish. And he had signed the order to kill all the Jewish people. So this is revelation for him. What are the confrontations that you have been avoiding? What are the conversations that you need to have that you know that God wants you to take care of? What are the misunderstandings that you need to clear up? Things that you've seen people who you care about doing or saying, and you know that they need to hear the truth, but you've not been telling them. If we're going to be super sheep, we have to love people enough to confront them even at great risk. Which brings us to number six. The king orders, and the king says to Esther, what are you talking about? And he says, who is this that's going to kill you? And she goes, Haman. And at that point you go, wow, the strategy of that. Esther, Xerxes, and Haman, the only three in the room. And the king gets angry and gets and he determines he's going to kill him, but he's so angry that he walks out of the room for a moment. And Haman knows he's a dead man. And so he goes over to plead with the queen and somehow ends up falling on top of her. This is like Hollywood, I'm telling you. This is perfect plot. Just as King Xerxes walking in and she, you know, he's falling on top of her and he gets, so you're going to assault my queen on top of everything else? And the servants come in, cover his head, and take him out, hang him. Which brings us to number six. He served with integrity, though the king did not deserve it. He served with integrity, though the king did not deserve it. You see, power often goes to people's head. They can be just great, normal people until they get into a position of power, then they lose their minds. But not Mordecai, because of his integrity, because he was grounded in what God wanted and what was best for others. It could have been, Mordecai could have justified being selfish because he was serving this pagan king who didn't deserve what Mordecai had to offer him, but he acted with integrity. With super sheep, serve with humility, remembering that it's only because God has placed them in a particular place or role or given them particular influence. It's only because God has done it and he wants them to use it for him. They serve for the good of others at cost to themselves, and they bring honor to God. Esther chapter 10, verse 3. Mordecai the Jew was second in rank to King Xerxes. After they killed Haman, Xerxes recognized the integrity, the good work of Mordecai, and put him in that role. And so he became vice emperor of the kingdom. Preeminent among the Jews and held in high esteem by his many fellow Jews because he worked for the good of his people and spoke up for the welfare of all the Jews. He was honored because he worked for the good of the people. It didn't go to his head. When God elevated him, he served with integrity and humility. I don't think it was on Mordecai's agenda to be promoted to the vice emperor. He was just doing the right thing. And that's what super sheep do. They risk to do the right thing and not worry about the consequences or what God's going to do. He just kept doing the right thing. And as a result, he was put in charge of doing the right thing for millions of people. Are there any areas of your life where you're not serving with integrity? Where you've compromised? Where you've fudged? You see, super sheep risk to do the right thing and serve with integrity in every area of their lives. So what do we do with this? I read this poem. There was a very cautious man who never laughed or played. He never risked, he never tried, he never sang or prayed. And when one day he passed away, his insurance was denied. For since he'd never really lived, they claimed he never died. Super sheep risk. They take chances. But they do it to do the right thing. Notice, at the beginning of the message, I ask you to notice how many of the things that we see in Mordecai were just ordinary and inconvenient. You see, Mordecai was just doing ordinary things. All of these risks that he took was just really ordinary things. They were inconvenient. They cost him. But they were things that we can do. So what about you? As we talked about Mordecai, are there some things that God wants you to do, little things, the right things that he wants you to do, that you need to do, that you're not doing? Would you bow your heads? Did God grab your heart while we were talking today? Did he identify something or someone that you need to take action on? God wants you to be a super sheep. Ordinary, but extraordinary because of what he does in our lives. And by doing the right things, we open our life. That's really what surrender is so much about. It's not so much a prayer that we pray, but rather it's listening to God and doing what he wants us to do. That's surrender, doing the right things instead of the things that are easy, convenient, or appealing. If there's something that you need to do, would you just in this moment commit to God and tell him, Lord, I'll do it. And I'll do it today or tomorrow or whenever the first opportunity is. I won't put it off, Lord. I'm going to do the right thing. And if you pray that, realize that God will marshal the forces of heaven to help you, just like he did with Mordecai. Not easy and not cheap, but he will help you in his power, his strength, so that you can experience that joy and freedom, fulfillment that he wants you to have. Lord, thank you for recording not just the obvious, prominent heroes, but for those who are much like us. Now we pray that you would help us to be like Mordecai. I pray that you would help everyone that has made that commitment to you to fulfill the commitment. Help them to see your pleasure with them. Help them to sense how much you are on their side. Lord, help them to experience the joy that comes after doing the right thing. Help us as a congregation, as a church body, as an army, as a family, to do the right thing. Give us your wisdom, your guidance, your strength, and the clarity that we need. Lord, show us, just as clear as you did Mordecai, what those right things are. Ordinary, but help us to be faithful to you. Now, Lord, we put ourselves into your hands as we go through this week. Keep what we've learned in front of us. Don't let us forget it as we walk out the door, but God, burn it into our souls. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Be sure and take your sermon outline to your small group, because this week we'll go back to talking about the sermon in the small groups and trying to process it together. We're going to do announcements here in a moment, but the first announcement is we want to highlight the... Susan, where are you? Come on up. To highlight the Festival of Hope, is that what it's called? The Festival of Hope. That Susan has been going through some training and gotten some heart for this thing. So what it is, it's called the Three Rivers Festival of Hope with Franklin Graham, Billy Graham's son. And so in lieu of the big crusades, week-long crusades that Billy Graham used to do, they're doing these smaller crusades and trying to get people to come and hear the Word of God. So you want to share a little bit about it?
Yeah, there is some information on the
hold it for you.
On the back table. The one is talking about they had the courses for being a counselor for the crusade, and they had good turnouts. A lot of churches are involved in that. They had a follow-up, and they've decided to do another follow-up of training for counselors. So if you miss those other opportunities, but God's put it on your heart that you really need to be involved in that, They are having two more, July 15th and 17th. That's this week, from 7 to 9, and it will be at their festival offices in Carnegie, and the information's on the back table.
So it's nice and close. And that's a course that you don't necessarily have to serve as a counselor.
Right,
but
right.
It's to train you how to talk about your faith with really anyone. So it really fits in with that 5 to 10 bookmark that we've been praying for. So it's a good opportunity to learn more about how do you connect with people and share your faith.
Right, and I found it helpful. Joanne and I went, and I chose not to be a counselor for that night, but have offered to do Bible studies afterwards if people come to Christ, to do a Bible study that will introduce them to, you know, the Word of God and everything. So if you go, they start out with a book, and it just goes through the steps. I mean, sometimes we feel like, oh, gee, you know, I don't know how to do that. I don't know what to say. I don't know what scripture to use. They have it all spelled out in this book for you, and they'll go through the steps. They'll inspire you with their stories and the lives that have been changed through these crusades. And they're not just in the United States of America. They go all over the world with these crusades. There was recently a newsletter out. I didn't think to bring it, but very inspirational stories about how lives are touched. And they were talking about how this one facility that was going to have a crusade a few days before the festival said, no, you can't use our facility. And they had all of these people coming, and this church opened up their facility, their ground, they pulled it together, and they had a wonderful festival with a lot of people coming to Christ, and this was in a foreign country. So many good things are happening, and as a church, and you know, we're a small church, but there are people that need to hear the message of Christ, and sometimes we feel like we don't know what to say. This book definitely will help you and walk you through the steps. They have scriptures in the back that you can memorize as you're talking to somebody about how people are sinful and there's a penalty for sin, and Christ paid that penalty. But salvation is a free gift, and Christ is the door to that, and we must receive him. It says, yet to all who receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So it's all in there, and if you choose to go to these classes, that'll be helpful. They also hand out different little pamphlets and things that you can take along with you, have in your pocket, so that if you're talking to someone that isn't saved, that you can share with them the gospel. If you choose to be a counselor, you know, once again, you're like, man, what do I say? And what if they say this? What if they say that? And, oh, I don't know. This is confusing. They got it all written out, you know. Step one, you know, you ask them, have you come forward to personally accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If they say yes, then you go to page 6 and 2 on here, you know. I'm not sure if I have eternal life. Then you go to page 6 and 3. You know, it's all spelled out in here, little pamphlet that will help you that night. And each person that comes forward to accept Christ will receive the Gospel of John, and it's all written out in here. And then there's a study guide after that that talks about your faith and what does that mean, and help you in your growth in Christ. And so this is given to the recipient, to the believer, to take home and to study. And then last of all, if they choose to go on and if they want more information, there's a book that they will give you, and it's called The Pathway to Christian Maturity, Discipleship Exercises, and it talks about scripture and how you can help that person walk to better understand that scripture. So I would highly recommend it. I don't feel like an evangelist myself, but I do think as a church, as a body of Christ, as a believer in Christ, that we continually need to be reaching out to those that are lost And I, you know, we hear the sermons here, and, you know, at times Herb will give that invitation. But sometimes people are moved by these festivals and the singers that are there and the power of the speaker. And so don't dismiss it. If God's not talking to you about it, fine. But if you God's putting this on your heart, I would highly recommend that you participate in some way with this great event.
Okay. So the class is Tuesday and Thursday.
Right.
For a couple of hours, I think.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's the class. And then the schedule for the festival itself is August 15th through the 17th. And as you look at that 5 to 10 list that you put together, there are, you know, if you say this is, you know, Billy Graham, right? And everybody's heard of Billy Graham. Well, this is his son, and this is one of those great events that, that they put together. And they might just be more willing to come and be a part of that. And then they've got guests, special musical guests, and usually a testimony each night at the event. That, and so people might just be more apt to come to console where you can be anonymous and hear Billy Graham's son come and speak. So
These are free. You don't pay anything to get in to this, nor does the people that you bring. They have been praying for 2 years. They've been working on this for 2 years. They've had a group of people that have been praying all this year for this festival. They have reached out to people for donations. And so because people that feel strongly about this have already donated the money, you can go without any cost to it.
Good. So if you have any questions about any of that, you can talk to Susan. She's been real involved. Okay.
I mean, a free Charlie Daniels concert. Come on now. If you look at the back of your program, just a couple more highlights. The Sunday and Tuesday small groups are on hiatus for the summer, so for the next 4 or 5 weeks. But there is still a Thursday night small group that meets here at headquarters at 7 o'clock. So if you'd like to come discuss the sermon more, or you just need a little bit more new song in your week, come out on Thursday night here at HQ. There is a baby shower today. I assume she's coming. All right. Well, there'll be a baby shower either way, right? Oh, yeah, that's excellent. It'll be like a white elephant gift, right? If she doesn't come, you ever just exchange your gifts. So if you have any questions about that, you can see Alicia. Or we can save them for the next baby shower. Her and Susan talked about the Tuesday, Thursday Christian class. Next Saturday already, the clay shoot? All right, so if you're interested in a clay shoot, it's going to be next Saturday. Please tell David today if you are interested. All right, so see David before, so he knows. Well, I'm sorry, what? The girls are shooting back? Okay. They can't friend any girl clays. That's all those clays. I'm sure we can arrange that, right, David? I'm sure. I also want to thank Chris White and Susan. The group that I mentioned last week was through here last night. 20 youth and 6 leaders from a Good Shepherd Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana, came through here on their way to Delaware. They're going to be working with Urban Promise, which is a group that they've worked with before, but they'll be doing a bunch of different things this week. They were very impressed with the accommodations, and they were very excited to get a little breakfast to hit the road. When I got here this morning and told the leader we had something for them, he said, "Oh, that's good. They need some sugar."